So then he said, I'll kill everything you love.
Oh,
the hoots we had. How are you, big damn Christopher?
I'm barely alive. How are you, big damn Mattathias?
I'm still ticking. Give me a licking and I still keep ticking. That's gross.
I don't know what that means.
Doesn't mean anything. Shut up! Shut up! Oh, Christopher, what a week it's been. For you, for me, for everybody. Pantomime going well, Chris?
It's going well. We're 18 shows in, so that's 18 down, 40-something to go.
Jesus, tonight!
Yes, that's in fact, that's what I had for my lunch.
Well, you know, you ate of his body, drank of his blood.
Oh, yes. He tasted like chicken.
It's what he would have wanted. It is actually what he wanted.
It is. He wanted us to have a nosh.
Oh, God. Christopher.
Mattstopher.
We've finally seen, as predicted by last week's episode, we've finally seen a good old look at Spider-Man Homecoming and his web wings.
And his filthy old sexy web wings.
Filthy old sexy web wings. And Vulture's filthy old sexy massive turbine wings. Which I'm quite enjoying. What do you think, Chris? As everyone's favourite Spider fan. Well, my favourite Spider fan. Well, my second favourite Spider fan. what do you think?
Such a very specific ranking. Thanks to the recent efforts from studios like Warner Brothers and everything, I try efforts, not to get excited.
It's a strong word.
Well, yeah. Very, very select buzzword.
Yeah.
I never tend to get, I let myself get too excited now with trailers, but, and it's a big but in blue lycra. I want to see the heck out of this movie.
I am on the same lines as you, my friend.
High school Peter
wait.
Parker, you know?
Yeah.
Being mentored by Tony Stark, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
With Michael Keaton as the Vulture wielding what looks like a bunch of tech made by the Tinkerer.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
I'm down with that. Happy Hogan. Ned Leeds dropping a Death Star Lego model into a million pieces.
Yeah. Oh, is that Ned Leeds?
It's Ned Leeds, yeah.
Oh, awesome.
He's in high school. Yeah.
Because he's clearly based on Gank from Ultimate Spider-Man.
Yeah.
But it's not Gank.
No.
Because I'm pretty sure there's also a scene in Ultimate Spider-Man where Gank sees Miles and drops a big Lego model. I think they've taken that scene from Ultimate Spider-Man.
I do believe that might be true, yeah. They made him Ned Leeds because I think this film, for example, has like Liz Allen in it and stuff.
Yeah,
like
they've
gone back to the high school crew. Whereas obviously Ned Leeds was a Bugle kid, wasn't he? But he was like a younger Bugle employee. But they've gone, sod it. He's going to be a high schooler. Peter needs a friend.
I'm okay with that. I'm cool with it. I'm cool
Peter,
with it.
Peter needs a friend that isn't Harry fucking Osborn. So.
Oh, God, yes, please. No more Harrys. Said the Scarlet Witch.
Wait, what?
No more Harrys.
What a very specific series. House of No More Harrys.
House of No More Harrys. No More Harrys for you. It's Dave's all the way. I'm really excited for it. It looks good. Action looks great. Humor's there. You guys aren't the Avengers.
Freaking Kirby masks.
Oh, yeah. It's so
they're
good.
All the Kirby designs. It's like, so yes.
Good. We've already seen really Avengers cool. merchandise in universe, so it works as well. We know that there are Avengers toys in the MCU. it looks great. Love the suit. Love the web wings. Love the... I'm going to touch the spider and it's going to get looser so I can pull it on and off really quick. Like that a lot.
Yes. I love the fact that shot was clearly also in the trailer just to go, hey, everybody. Tom Holland's a little bit buff.
Oh, yeah. Tom Holland is very
come
young,
to the movie.
But real buff.
Ladies, gents, he's legal and ripped. Come see the movie.
Aren't you lucky? Oh dear. Yeah, no, I'm super excited for it. Michael Keaton looks great. He looks like a genuinely threatening villain. And that, yeah, that vulture get up looks really good. Makes him look huge.
You know, the leaked toy image from a few weeks ago made me go, yeah. But no, seeing that mask in live action.
Yeah.
Like, it looks freaky. Like, it's got kind of like a Star-Lord meets Falcon kind of thing going on.
Yeah.
But sinister, because, you know, he's got a fuzzy collar, so that and makes him evil.
I wouldn't be surprised if it's referenced that this stuff is based on sort of like reverse engineered Falcon stuff or whatever. I like the little ruff around his neck, which makes him look vulture-y, which is, again, a reference to the original costume, as well as, you know, the fact that he's a fucking vulture. Yeah, no,
there's like green tints to the coat and the metal as well, keeping the green scheme. There's a very brief glimpse of Shocker in the trailer somewhere.
Yeah. Oh, well, there's two trailers, isn't there? There's an international one.
The international one, which is mostly the same, but there's a tiny bit of extra Peter and Tony dialogue.
Yeah.
And, there's an extra shot of something. I think it's of Shocker, actually. Yeah, he's in that one, isn't he? In the scrapyard.
It's a slightly different sequence as well, I think.
Watching it back before we recorded, actually, I noticed that when Peter's being smashed into the bus, and then when he's lay on what looks like the beach or whatever, covered in blood, he's in the makeshift costume.
Yeah, that's been pointed out. From Civil War. That's interesting. What's he going to... is he going to go back to wearing that? I wonder what the deal is there.
Is it a scene that we're shown from maybe, like, earlier in his career?
I feel like this is his first sort of supervillain fight. So, he's been fighting muggers and bank robbers and stuff and, like, hoodlums and whatever for a while. And, like, keeping the streets safe. But this is his first, like... Oh, these are legitimate supervillains.
Forget the flying monster man.
Yeah, don't do it. You can't fight him. But I gotta fight him because I'm Spider-Man. But don't do it. You can't fight him. But I gotta do it because I'm Spider-Man.
I'm a Spider-Man. See?
Get me pictures of Spider-Man. We've not got pictures. We've got footage. Oh yeah. Huzzah! I'm excited. I'm excited for that. But that's not the only movie news we've got this week. We got some other things going on.
Oh,
some,
by Jingo?
Some big movements over at Warner Brothers.
Oh, by Gringo?
Strap yourself in, because I'm going to hit you with some big old headlines, and then I'm going to explain them to you, all right? All right, okay. So first up, Justice League 2 has been moved back. Zack Snyder's taking a break from DC movies.
Good.
The Batman has apparently been moved up, but Ben Affleck is not rushing the script. Patrick Wilson has been cast as Ocean Master for Aquaman.
Oh.
The bad guy is Ocean Master, and he's Patrick Wilson.
Yeah, and James Wan's the director, so...
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. He's using talent he likes to work with, who he knows is good. All right, that's interesting. Yeah.
David Ayers is doing another movie.
Yeah, this news did hit me, yeah. This is...
He's doing Gotham City Sirens with Margot Robbie's Harley Quinn.
Oh, God.
And it's being written by someone whose name I can't remember.
It's the lady who wrote the new the new Tomb Raider game, the first one.
Yeah, not the game, she's writing the film.
Oh, she's writing the film too?
She didn't write the game. She's writing the new film.
Gotcha. Okay.
And she wrote Whiskey Tango Foxtrot and a couple of other things, I think, which I can't find right now.
Let's be honest. So you and me with our real softer genders, I think we're both awesome female writing talent. About damn freaking time. It's a David Ayer directed Gotham City Sirens movie.
Oh no, she didn't. She didn't write Whiskey Tango Foxtrot. Sorry, she wrote. Geneva Robertson Duaret, who is working on the script for the Tomb Raider remake and Sherlock Holmes 3. I got confused because I was reading about Robbie's credits. That's why.
oh, fair enough.
Yeah. So that's who's writing the script. I don't know what else she's done. I'm gonna IMDb her and see what it's like. But yeah, I mean. The idea I'm down with. I'm not a huge fan of Robbie's Harley Quinn. I'm not a huge fan of David Ayer. So
that's my biggest beef is that I don't like the characters in this universe at all.
No.
So to suddenly go, hey, look, they've all been around for a while, and here's two others you've not met in this version yet, and look at how much they're all getting on. It's like, there's no payoff there. There'd be a payoff if we'd had a Batman movie with Catwoman in it already, and you know, Harley Quinn was in Suicide Squad or what have you, and maybe Poison Ivy was in something else. Do you know what I mean? Like, then yeah. It'd be like, okay, team those three up. That'd be great. But they missed the point of Harley Quinn. They've missed the point of Batman. I don't want to watch a film miss the point of two other characters I like as well. It's weird.
Well, I'm looking at Geneva Robertson-Duarte's writing credits here on IMDb. She's got 7 writing credits, none of which have actually been produced yet. They've all only been announced for 2018.
Okay.
So she's writing a Visionaries movie. You know, Visionaries, Knights in the Magic Light, Magical Light, Hasbro, toys with the hologram faces, yeah. She's writing Sherlock Holmes 3. She's writing ROM, which is another Hasbro toy movie. She's writing Mask, Mobile Armored Strike Command, which is another Hasbro toy movie. She's writing Gotham series Sirens. She's writing Dungeons and Dragons. And she's writing the Tomb Raider reboot.
Okay.
As far as I can see, she hasn't actually had anything produced yet.
I've got alarm bells ringing now, because this just says to me, they've gone, hey, you can write scripts maybe based around stuff we want to sell.
I mean, unless she's like a super talented young up-and-comer, I don't know anything about her. And if she's some like super talented young up-and-comer, then this might be really good, because they're taking a risk on new talent. But
we could get a Lego movie kind of scenario here, where it's like, oh shit, that works really well. But like you say, there's nothing we can watch to see, really. And that slate is just very, hi, I'm good at saying yes to jobs, even if it means I have to try and create a story out of this plastic thing.
It looks like she's done a fair bit of TV.
Okay, all right. I'm not doubting that she's not cut her teeth, but it's just that whole saying she's going to be in charge. Right. She's going to be in charge of this kingdom. But is she there because she's the best person for the job, or is she there because she said yes? Basically,
she's got a blacklist script called Hibernation. So that'll be where she's just been discovered.
Oh, good. Okay, right.
A lot of writers are pulled off the blacklist, so that's...
Nice.
That's promising. If she's got a blacklist script, that is probably...
That's good.
She's probably got some talent, so that's
good. She's got stories she wants to tell.
Yeah.
This just may be what she has to tell right now.
So that's okay. I'm unsure about Gotham City Sirens. It's an interesting angle to take, but it feels like a weird thing to go, okay, we did this ensemble movie... that didn't quite work, so we're going to do a solo movie, but actually we're going to make it a different ensemble movie. So what we're going to do, instead of giving this character that we want to explore more room to breathe in a solo movie, we're going to stick her in another ensemble movie and fill it with characters that we're probably not going to handle very well.
See, I think the idea of a Gotham City Sirens movie is a lot more palatable than a Harley Quinn solo film, but I think that's just because I don't understand why you would give that stage of her life Harley a solo story.
Well, I also don't like that. I just don't like Margot Robbie's Harley that much.
No, I'm so baffled by the amount of press coverage in relation to Sirens this week, where they've gone, Robbie's Harley Quinn was universally acclaimed, so people are really excited. Was she?
It wasn't.
Was she?
We didn't acclaim it. That's not universal.
She was fine, and that's it. And even then, she was fine at playing the Joker's girlfriend, which was the character she was... playing. She wasn't playing Harley Quinn.
I was not in love with that portrayal.
Jared Leto wasn't playing the Joker. He was playing Harley Quinn's boyfriend. Neither of them were playing the characters they shared the names of. So why would I want to see her in a movie? Now, if you say to me that, oh Christ, do you know what this says to me though? The Joker should have been the antagonist of the Suicide Squad movie. They should have just flat out made the Joker the villain.
When it first started seeing trailers, I thought that was what was going to be the case, but
me too, yeah. Like, because that's the sort of mission that you would give to the Suicide Squad.
You have to have a big old blue light in the sky.
And a freaking supernatural villain. We've got to be prepared for a Superman-level threat. So here's an Australian drunk with a boomerang. Here's a freaking crocodile man who just sort of hits things. Here's a fire-wielding demon man who doesn't actually do anything because he doesn't want to. And here's a crazy woman with a bat. Enjoy! Christ alive.
Oh, and a guy shoots really well. Apparently, they're also They're possibly tapping Will Smith for a solo Deadshot movie.
Do you know what makes me think this? I think his toys have sold well. Because I was in Toys R Us in Lincoln today, and I saw a bunch of Suicide Squad toys that I'd never seen before.
I hadn't seen them anywhere before apart from Toys R Us.
Yeah, amongst them was a Batman figure, which is Batman with a swappable head with the breather mask from one of the scenes. Right. It was all right. It was basically a repackage of the Dawn of Justice figure, which in itself, like, it's amazing to think that it's nearly a year since that movie and I've not bought a single toy from it because I don't like them. I don't like the characters enough to want to do it, and I'm a toy freak. But they had Captain Boomerang figures.
Yeah.
Which were just sort of repainted Bane figures from the Movie Masters wave with a new head. Sure. I shit you not, it's the exact same coat sculpt and everything.
Alright, okay.
But interestingly, they've recently been putting out, and you and I saw some of B&M Bargains of the Week, these like 16-inch tall action figures.
Oh yeah, the enormous Dawn of Justice ones, yeah.
Yeah, they have Deadshot in Toys R Us.
Yeah.
And it's an alright likeness, and it's just weird, because it's like, is this why? Is it because they want to keep Will sweet, or is it because he sold some merch? So they're like, yeah, we'll give him a solo movie. I don't know, man. I don't care enough about Deadshot to want to watch a Deadshot film. I also think that the only reason they're doing it is because his name is Deadshot, and you might get the bargain bin Disney knockoff effect where grandmothers buy a film called, like, Ice Queen because the cover looks like Frozen. You'll get people buying Deadshot for their kids or their teenagers because they think it's Deadpool, basically.
That's sadly cynical, but probably true.
It's weird, isn't it? Yeah. Which is also maybe an insult to Deathstroke. Hey, you're so unmemorable in a way that we're completely looking at the other guy now.
That's... Ooh.
Yeah.
Oh, no. No! That's left a bad taste in my mouth.
Yeah, well, that's just Warner Brothers right for the moment. Like, nothing but bad taste. I hate to say this, after watching the latest trailer for the Lego Batman movie, I'm even slightly holding back on that.
Because the new TV, the latest trailer, so...
Well, the new TV spot is... It's mostly sort of footage we've seen before, but this time it's Joker-heavy. And it seems the plot of the new movie is that the Joker has amassed a group of the worst villains known to mankind. And by worst villains, I don't mean, like, you know, most deadly.
No.
I mean, like, Eraserhead, Condiment King.
Yeah.
Like these characters. And is taking over Gotham in, like, one big final bid for domination. I don't mind that so much, just because, like, they announced that the first new wave of individual blind bag Lego figures coming out next year is a Lego Batman wave, and all of the characters are, like, obscure Batman villains, like King Tut and things like that.
I mean, that's something different.
So that's kind of fun. You know, like, what's it, like, Ten-Eyed Man and characters like this. But Zach Galifianakis' voice is featured heavy in the new trailer, and it just sort of sounds, eh?
Hmm.
Like, he just sounds like this. He's like, oh, come on, Batman. Ah, damn it, I'm your enemy. And it's like, really? I mean, Will Arnett's playing jokey, piss-take, you know, broody Batman, and he's giving it all this. He's doing this voice and everything. Like, to hear the Joker just sound just like Zach Galifianakis, it's like, oh, okay, we're doing this. But also, you remember I spotted the Gremlins in the original trailer on the Batplane?
Yes.
Seems that might actually be the film's tie-in with merchandise. It's not just a Warner Brothers reference. I think Lego Dimensions has opened up a whole new realm of copyright. Because spotted in the new TV spot is a shot with Batman and Robin on a Dalek ship. It's very fleeting, but it's definitely the Ruddy Daleks. Yeah. Now, I won't judge till I've seen the film, really. Because it could be like some kind of jokey plot about they've bust into another another playset to try and get something or whatever. But it does seem a bit... Really?
Really? Yeah, that's what I think about that. That's strange. Yeah,
I can't wait for the Big Finish spin-off. About Lego Daleks.
Oh, you just wait. You just wait. I wonder how the voice will be different. I wonder what...
That's a good question, actually, because if they get dialogue, you think they'd cast Nicholas Briggs. But, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if they didn't.
You don't really cast Nicholas Briggs. He just comes as part of the package.
Hello. Oh, hi, Nicholas.
I think he's written into the Dalek rights at this point.
I am the Terry Nation estate.
I am. I am all the Daleks. No, I literally am. I literally am all the Daleks. I'm made of tiny Daleks. I hadn't seen that TV spot, so I guess I'm... Yeah, but if that... What you'll say is true, then... Yeah, I'm a little worried for that.
Yeah, it's odd. Yeah, Bloody odd.
As I mentioned, The Batman. Affleck said, Ben Affleck's like, so Justice League 2's been pushed back. Snyder's like, oh, I'm going to take a break for a little bit. That Snyder bit's not been necessarily confirmed yet, but that's the scuttlebutt. And apparently they've moved the Batman up to try and fill the gap.
Wait, hang on. We were going to get Justice League 2 before the Batman.
Yeah.
That's a really odd thought.
Because the Batman's not had a date announced yet.
My God.
So they're looking... It's looking like... Because Justice League 2 was originally 2019.
Yeah.
And that's been pushed back. So they're thinking that the Batman's going to come up to take the place of June 14th, 2019, which was the original release date for Justice League 2. But that's not been confirmed yet. Because they were going to be filmed... Because the two Justice League films were going to be filmed back-to-back. But now they've... Pardon me. But apparently now, because we shuffled them around, Snyder's going to take a break from DC movies. He's going to direct something he's been working on called The Last Photograph, which is a Afghanistan set thriller that he's been working on since after 300. He's hoping to start filming that later next year. So that'll push back Justice League 2 a bit further. But then, so the assumption was, oh, they're going to bring up Batman and fill that gap. But then Affleck turned around and said, well, I've not got a finished script yet and I'm not going to rush it because, and I quote, he's not in any hurry to jam the mediocre movie down the pipe. Not a mediocre movie, the mediocre movie. So,
oh God.
The full quote is, we still have to get a screenplay together. I am writing it, but that doesn't mean it'll be good. If I can find the right idea, there's nothing I'd love more than to do to direct a standalone, iconic, great Batman movie. But it's been done. Chris Nolan did three really good movies, and I'm really mindful of that. So I'm not in any hurry to jam the mediocre movie down the pipe. If we do it, I want to make sure we get the great version. One that's worthy of the tradition of guys like Tim Burton and Christopher Nolan and Christian Bale.
So Affleck is basically openly admitting that, yeah, we probably shouldn't be doing this right now.
It's just a weird quote.
So, I'm taking my time, but I think Warner Brothers wants me to hurry the fuck up.
He said earlier on, he's like, I'm a real believer in not reverse engineering projects to meet a window or date, but rather when you get the right idea, when you get the right story, you get the right thing, then you make the movie. So that's what we're doing, and I'm hoping to get that done. So the whole thing just sounds kind of uncertain. Like, I don't really know where it's going. It's, I'm... What's going on with the Batman? Like, that's strange. Warner Brothers is all in a bit of a hole right now.
It's really odd, man, the whole thing.
It's very strange. Very strange.
So freaky. As freaky as, man.
But, Christopher, you know what is pretty positive?
My sperm count?
No, the reception for Rogue One.
By Jiminy Greaves.
That movie's out Friday, I think, here.
But sooner, actually. If you're listening to this podcast, it's already out. We're recording it. We're recording it on Wednesday the 14th. It's out over here in precisely 2 hours and 15 minutes.
Holy shitballs.
Yeah, I've got premiere tickets booked for tomorrow night with the band.
Ooh, I think I'm probably not going to see it till the start of next week.
Because I shall not like, spoil a ting by Jing.
Because it's not like we can do a podcast before then anyway.
I think the way we'll do this in terms of Rogue One is I think we'll talk about it on next week's episode, sort of a bit non-spoilery, and then we'll have a proper good old spoiler natter next week. That gives you all a chance to see it by Jing.
But Christopher,
Madstifer,
thanks to the magic of audio production, we don't have to record an episode next week.
What the balls?
Because we've already recorded it.
Next
week. Next week is our Christmas special.
I thought it was the week after.
No, because it's the 23rd next week, isn't it?
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh my God, that's so weird.
We're just over a week away from Christmas, Christopher.
Oh my God, my brain hurts.
I know.
I know, honey.
We won't have an episode on which to talk about Rogue One next week, unless you want to do unless you want to do a bumper double episode.
No, do you know what? We'll chat about it the week after. There you go, you ungrateful swines. Hey! You've got an extra week. An extra week to see Rogue One, I tells you.
Time for the new year. And then we can go properly spoilery on it then, you see.
Oh, that's a good plan. But see, yes, ladies and gentlemen, prior planning, preparation, and a lack of calendar in your temporary digs can do wonderful things.
Your calendar's on your phones, Christopher. Stop complaining.
Oh my God, I can't believe it's Christmas.
It's nearly
like
Christmas.
A week and a bit.
So yeah, it's Rogue One's gone down pretty well. Some people it's very different, apparently.
Yes, I hear
tell. Very different for a Star Wars movie, but not necessarily in a bad way. And yeah, not much more to say about that other than the buzz has been generally good, so I'm excited to see it.
One recurring element I have heard in some of the reviews I've listened to and read so far is, and I'll say this now as a public service announcement. Apparently, if you're going into the movie expecting oodles of Darth Vader, don't. Because it's not his story.
No.
It's just set at a time when he's around. So
you shouldn't be going into this movie expecting oodles of Darth Vader. If you are, you're silly.
Yeah, well, apparently a few of the people who went to the premiere were like, why wasn't there more Vader? It's like, because it's not his bloody movie, that's why.
Not Vader. But yeah.
It's not about Vader.
So we'll see how much Vader is actually in it. But that's a story for another day. Last little scrap of news.
Oh, dirty news scraps.
Move on to questions, because I want to get all these questions done this week, ready for Christmas. So, this is the one for you, really, Christopher. This is a little tease for you. So, you know that Jekyll series that you like so much?
Yes, I think I know what this news is. I haven't read it, but I've got a suspicion. Hit me.
That's being made into a film. With Sirens director Ruben Fleischer, adapted by Anthony Bagarozzi and Charles Mondry.
Based on the Stephen Moffat scripted miniseries. That's so weird, because it exists. Why do you need a film?
And they've cast Chris Evans, Captain America himself, as Jekyll.
What?
Yes.
So it's
not part of the upcoming Universal Monsters the universe, because that's also called Jekyll. It's a separate Jekyll movie.
Yeah, because it's in the public domain.
Yeah.
Anyone could make a Jekyll and Hyde movie. Mm. Oh, bloody hell. Christ's sake. Oh, I don't know how I feel about that, apart from... So,
Chris Evans is Tom Jackman in the Jekyll movie.
I like Chris Evans. But James Nesbitt in that miniseries, I mean, it feels like it was written for him. And he's superb in it.
Probably was.
Oh, that's so weird.
Yes, it's very strange.
This means it's going to be American and, I don't know, it doesn't have the same vibe.
Yeah.
I mean, all right, I'm open to it, but it's like the fact that, you know, the... I can't remember which one it is. I think it's the Black Mirror episode about the girl on the run in the second series, where it turns out that she's actually a bit more of a guilty party than you think.
Mm.
It's like, I think that's the episode that Robert Downey Jr. has optioned the rights to for his movie company to make it to a film. It's like, it exists. The film exists. It's an hour and 10 minute long episode of a show called Black Mirror. Leave it alone.
Hmm.
Oh my god.
Yeah,
did you see the trailer? Did you see the trailer for the new Emma Watson, Karen Gillan, Tom Hanks, John Boyega film?
No, I missed
It's basically, you know, the Toby Kebbell Black Mirror episode with the lenses, the contact lenses.
Oh yeah, yeah. The Complete History of Me. Have you?
That's the one. Yeah, it's basically that as a film. Like it's a mogul played by Tom Hanks introducing the idea of being completely aware of everyone's activity and history and like
that is
sort of very, you know,
yeah, that's
like a slicker, sexier right now hashtag right now sexy slicker version of sort of the Bryce Dallas Howard episode of Series 3.
Yeah.
Okay. So a little less Stepford Wives and a bit more like Watchdogs, I suppose. It's just a bit like, okay, but we've seen people tell these stories recently and they tell them well. Mm. So, I don't know how I feel about the Jekyll movie, man. It's just so weird.
No, I thought that would tickle your brain.
Gosh, darn it. Maybe Chris Evans has got a really wild, oddball, crazed performance in him that he's just desperate to like have a go at,
I think he has.
You know, this is his chance to sort of go, "Hey, mother truckers, look at me! I'm amazeballs."
But let's truck along, Chris, because we've got to keep this episode brief. Because
like you're my pants,
and I'm exhausted, and it's nearly Christmas.
Jing, 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 jing,
so
jing,
let's
jing.
Dig. Deep into questions. We've got 4 emails and I'm going to get through them all this week, alright? Including one that we failed to pick up on last week from Tom. Hello, Tom.
Tom Monty. The man from Tom Monty
say, "Hey, Chris and Matt. Tom Monty here. Thanks for answering my questions in 23. It was great to hear your responses. If you've caught up with class, I'm afraid I don't have any thoughts on it this week, as I myself had forgotten of the show's existence until it was time to write this message. If you have, not quite, then I assume it hasn't gotten any better. If not, then worse. Coming back to this message, apparently there's a weeping angel cliffhanger in the final episode, and worse, it snaps someone's neck." Oh! I just rolled over that spoiler right there. That didn't happen. "My favourite Disney movie of all time has to be The Lion King. The message behind it, the atmosphere, and most importantly, the soundtrack, not only make my Disney favorite, favorite Disney movies, but one of my favorite movies. I watched it a lot during my infant years, and that makes it a very nostalgic watch." That's going back to our last week's topic about
Disney movies.
And favorite Disney movies. Yeah, Lion King's great. Not one of my favorites. Oh, it's very good, and it's a solid core of that Renaissance era. Good choice. Lion King's great. But
I think it may be my favourite Shakespeare adaptation to film, actually.
Yeah, it is pretty good for that. That's very true.
I dig Lion King, man.
I dig Lion King. The live action remake's a really weird idea, because like there's no human characters in that movie.
I trust Favreau, but how can you make live action unless, like The Jungle Book, some of the sets are physical?
Yeah.
And that's it.
Yeah.
You know? I forgot to ask you actually last week. What is your favourite Disney movie, would you say?
Are we including Pixar or are we just going mainstream Disney?
Just the mainstream. Just the Walt Disney Pictures proud to present. Yeah.
I'm probably going to have to go with... I'm gonna go with, and it's a tough one, Aladdin.
Ooh, good choice though.
Because Aladdin and Beauty and the Beast are two of the earliest movies I can remember seeing in the cinema, and Aladdin's amazing.
Aladdin's a damn good one.
It's just great.
I'm always a little torn. My favourite is The Hunchback of Notre Dame.
Oh, yeah, that's real good. That is real good.
Yeah. I have one big qualm with it, and that's the confirmation that the gargoyles are alive. I absolutely hate that. Like, one of them's constantly molesting the goat, and the other one throws a rock at someone during the big scuffle at the end. So it confirms that they're real. If they'd left out those two bits, I'd be like, okay, I don't mind them being weird. They're all in Quasi's head. He made them up to talk to. That makes sense. But the music is astounding and insanely adult for Disney. And also, I think their best film, though, in terms of like the one that I'm like, that's the one where if someone says, I've never watched a Disney movie before, what should I watch? I always point them to Beauty and the Beast.
Yeah, Beauty and the Beast.
Because I think it's such a good film.
It's a very special movie. And I'm still unsure about the remake. Still
same.
On the fence about that. But they've been pretty good so far, so.
Yeah, well, one of my fellow cast members at the Panto, I shan't say who for, you know, non-disclosure agreement reasons, and I shan't say exactly what he did, but he did some performance capture work and choreography for the film.
Oh, wow.
So he told me a couple of little tidbits about behind-the-scenes life, but nothing else because he could be killed by a giant mouse. So
killing. We'll have no killing here. No killing at all.
Oh, will we? But yeah, and also, a little update from last week's episode. I have seen Moana for a second time.
Oh, awesome.
It is awesome. It's so good.
I didn't
blub this time because I went with one of my cast members who was like, right, you've gone on about it. I've got to see it. Like, where's the cinema? I was like, right, we've got 3 hours. If we go now, we can catch a showing and get back in time for our half-hour call.
Hey.
So we legged it. And we did. And when it got to that bit early on, he turned to me and went, yeah, I understand.
I get it.
And his eyes were glassy. So it was like, yay! I'm not just a tired stranger in a different city sitting in the cinema crying.
You are a tired stranger in a different city. Yes. It's always nice to have confirmation that you're not insane.
Yay!
Let's get into some questions from Tom Monson. Three brief questions, and then a bunch of Doctor Who ones. Home Alone versus Home Alone 2.
Home Alone.
Home Alone. Although 2 has its charms, it is basically a remake.
And to be fair, the final act of Home Alone 2 goes hard as a motherfucker. It takes the concept and ramps it up, but also it has Donald Trump being nice to a child. So
yeah, it's sort of
soured now.
I know that movie's got some fantasy elements, but that is a little bit too far for me.
However, we must at least give a special mention of love and adoration to the line reading, have a lovely day! I love you! that first one's just so perfect. It's great. Yeah. That first one's amazing.
Yeah. It's really good. It's real good, and I'm going to watch it soon. who would you say has won this year's Christmas ad contest? John Lewis is disappointing me this year, and Waitrose or M&S is probably my winner. I have completely ignored the Christmas ads because... fuck consumerism. Next!
We say talking about Star Wars at length.
Shut up! I'm not a hypocrite. You're a hypocrite.
I hate the song, but love the animation of the Sainsbury's advert. It's this big stop motion, like ongoing thing, but it goes on for far too long.
I've not seen any of them because I don't watch TV anymore.
This attacked me at the start of a YouTube video, and I went, "Oh, that's gorgeous animation," and then the song started, and I went, "Oh, this song's a bit annoying. These vocals are just a bit whiny. Who the hell did these?" Yeah, James Corden, so that says a lot.
Oh well, there we go.
Yeah.
Final question before we dip into Doctor Who. Have you seen Rick and Morty? If so, are you excited for season 3? When do you think it will finally air?
I've recently corrupted a cast member. They have now binged both of the first two series in the last 2 days.
Oh, it's so good. It's so good. I'm so excited
He came into work this morning and went, that's how it ends?
Yeah.
And I went, yep.
That's how it ends.
And then whenever we had any rhubarb moments in the pantomime today, I just kept telling him things were on a cob.
Excellent.
We freaking love Rick and Morty, and I think we will, when Series 3 drops, I think we'll probably do a Rick and Morty-themed episode as well.
Yeah, I'd like to do that. I could do that.
I would love to do that. Sleepy Gary can join us.
Oh, Sleepy Gary.
Maybe we'll see Chewbacca. I like that.
Oh, I need to go watch some Rick and Morty now.
Remember to collect the leftover schleim to be repurposed in later batches, okay? That's how you look. You've got to make sure that when you're making your plumbus, all right, it is ripe. Yeah.
Do we need to know who John Michael Vincent is to get this?
No, probably not.
No, it's fine.
I think Series 3 was rumoured to be dropping...
Sorry.
Like flies, apparently. Are you all right? Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Okay. Series 3 was rumoured to be... The excitement killed him. My God.
Yeah.
Series 3 was rumoured to be dropping this winter.
Yeah.
And as we're coming to the close of December, that says to me that possibly... I'm thinking February.
Yeah, January or February would be a good time, I think.
That'd be a good time. Because if we get it February, then it would go on till at least sort of May, June. Because I think they said there's 13 episodes this time instead of 10.
Yeah.
Which I'd be down with. Ooh wee!
So I'm, give me some Rick and Morty in my face.
Oh, baby.
Right, Chris, let's get stuck into Tom Monty's Doctor Who questions reluctantly.
The quagmire.
Face on.
It's Matt and Chris, two lifelong Doctor Who fans, reluctantly answer Doctor Who questions. Ooh wee you. Ooh, ooh. Cross the void beyond the mind, etc.
What do you think an 11th Doctor by Russell T. Davis would have been like if it wasn't Matt Smith?
Oh, shit. I don't know. I think he would have gone the more classic route, if I'm honest. Yeah, I think he would have gone for an older actor and everything, yeah.
Older.
Yeah. I think you would have seen someone like James Nesbitt in the role.
Yeah, possibly.
You know, just or like the forever linked to the role Rory Kinnear, someone like that.
Of course. See, Rory Kinnear's like, I can see why he's a good actor, but he doesn't have that sort of zaniness that I'd expect from a doctor actor. That sort of otherworldliness that a lot of these people have.
Well, maybe we've not seen it, by Jing. Maybe we've not it's seen waiting.
It. Maybe we've not seen his bits and pieces. Who knows?
But, oh God, dirty bugger. At the same time, I think I'm glad we had Matt. He's one of my faves. And also, Russell did write him in Sarah Jane Adventures, Death of the Doctor.
Yeah.
So, yeah. What about you? Do you think he would have gone for?
I've no idea.
Patterson Joseph.
Oh, God, that's pretty great, actually. No, I think probably, yeah, I think you're right. I think he would have veered older.
Who frowned me this face? Oh, yeah, the contestant on Bad Wolf.
Hey!
Remember him? He frowned me this face.
That guy. I don't know. I think he would have gone in the opposite direction to Matt. Like, it would have been... After having sort of a young, dashing, charming doctor with David Tennant, I think he would have gone in the opposite direction and gone for an older, gentleman Leo. Do people throw around Bill Nighy a lot? I don't think that would have been a bad shout, but...
I think we're Doctor Who on in the 90s. I think Bill Nighy would have been perfect.
Yeah.
I also think Bill Nighy would have been...
Bill Nighy, the science guy.
Or at least an episode where he guest stars as another Time Lord.
Yeah, why not?
Bill Nighy, the science guy.
In a world where the 50th anniversary took place during the 9th Doctor's era, and thus with RTD in charge, what would it have looked like, and could you pitch a brief outline overall outcome of the story's plot, and what Doctors would RTD have brought back?
If it had happened while the 9th Doctor was still around?
Yeah.
I think Chris Eccleston would have been bored of the role about 5 years in, probably.
Yeah. It wouldn't have looked like anything, because it wouldn't have happened.
Pretty much. Unless you just want to picture like how a Russell T. Davis 50th would have been.
Yeah.
In that case, similar, I think. I think it would have been similar, but I don't think the Time War would have played a part in it at all.
I think it would have been similar to End of Time, in a way, with...
Stolen Earth, maybe.
I think it probably would have been a regeneration story.
Oh, shit. Maybe a Five Doctors for the modern era.
Yeah.
Although, if it was just the Ninth Doctor, then maybe not.
I think no. If you, because I think by the 50th, a lot of the other Doctors were just too old to come back. Really, you couldn't have brought back Sylvester. You could have brought back Paul McGann, but you couldn't have brought back. You maybe could have brought back Sylvester. Probably not Colin. Maybe Peter. And Tom. Yeah, you could have done Tom, but it'd have to be something like
Dimensions in Time. Good luck. Good luck, my dears. The Rani, she hates me. She even hates children. It's like, oh my god. Fucking Dimensions in Time.
Dimensions in Time.
Oh my god.
Yeah, no, it would have looked like Dimensions in
Dementia
Time.
Dementia in Time.
It would have looked like Dimensions in Time. It would have been a crossover with EastEnders again. But would have been. Now it would have
crossover
been set
with Corey.
In 2033.
Crossover with Corey.
No,
take advantage of the cobbles. Yeah, but he would have found a way.
No, it wouldn't. It would have been a Corey. It had to be EastEnders.
Gotham, he would have found a way.
And it would
have found a way.
It would establish Rose Tyler as part of the EastEnders canon. and it would have had Danny Dyer in it, because Danny Dyer is in EastEnders now, I guess.
Apparently, we need to watch the Who Do You Think You Are episode about him.
Do we, though?
Apparently, it is incredible television, because he's just so gormless and fake.
Is it, though? Is it incredible television?
I've heard it is a laugh and worth a gander, so I'm tempted.
I'll pitch. Okay.
You'll bitch. What?
No, I'll pitch a brief outline of an RTD Ninth Doctor 50th anniversary special.
Oh, mince.
He fights the Daleks. The Daleks try to destroy everything. He hits a big red button. Everything gets reset, and then he regenerates.
Ba-dum-tish.
That's it. There we go.
That's it?
Basically all of Russell's finales.
How dare you, sir? I mean, yes, but how dare you, sir?
That's how you outline them. That's how they happen.
How dare you sully the name of Russell T. Bay?
Another one. Another question. quick, before we get caught up on it. Have you heard the reports of the show getting a clean slate in 2018 with Chibbers? I would really like to see a new Doctor. I love Capaldi, but his character is all over the place. And a complete reboot, like you said last week. How do you think they should handle a reboot if the rumours are true? It should not be a reboot. Doctor Who goes on forever. It should be. It just should be a clean slate, like you say. New Doctor, new companion, new feel, new tone,
new theme, interior, new creatures, whole new team of writers, new composer,
new writers, new composer, new everything. Just clean house completely. No one who worked on the Moffat era should be working on the show come Chris Chibnall's time. Apart from obviously Chris Chibnall, because they chose Chris Chibnall. Just fresh slate. And I know it's a generic question, but who should be the replacement? I'm fine if it isn't a woman. I don't think the show would survive. I'm not a sexist. It's just in my eyes, the Doctor is a man. I think we're lucky that Moffat isn't getting another Doctor, because I genuinely think he would choose a woman after what he did to the Master. Although a clean slate would be the perfect time to change the gender if they were ever to do it. I have faith in Chibnall to make the right choice. My ideal 13 would be someone like Dominic West or perhaps Bill Nighy, despite them being fairly big names. Thanks again, and I apologise as you again, or as you put myself for the length and number of questions. P.S. Loved your appearance on 5 Who Fans last week. I'm glad you found Chris, Matt. Thank you. But yeah, reboot. What would you do? What you want? What do you want from Chibnall's series, and who do you think should be a replacement? And we touched on that last week, I think, didn't we? I kind of said, like, I can't really think of anyone on the scene at the moment who I think would do a good job. Be it man, be it woman, be it a small, furry creature from Alpha Centauri.
Be it shooty dog thing. Yeah. Like I said last week, like if it wasn't the fact that he's a successful Hollywood actor, I still would love to see Chiwetel Ejiofor play the part.
Yeah, that's a really good shout, actually.
Mostly because I want to see all the news channels handle the pronunciation of his name.
Oh yeah.
But yeah, no one really strikes me as you, like, and anyone who I'm like, oh, maybe, has been in it or been in the spin-offs, and it's just like, eh. Because I'm still weird about the whole who frowned me this face? And then the casual, oh, I've sort of remembered it was the guy from Rome because I remembered that I need to think about the little people. So that's why I have this face.
That's
like,
yeah.
What?
Sure.
What?
Sure.
It's weird. Weird because you also look like that politician who committed suicide and murdered his own wife and children to save them from a difficult decision. So that's in your same universe. Mm. So it's weird. I just clean everything, wipe it out,
wipe them out, or love them.
I mean,
do you
ideally,
get a regeneration scene, or do you just want to just have him turn up a la Eccleston?
I think fans would be pissed off if you didn't regenerate now. But I'd be fine with, as weird as it sounds, because it's almost tradition, is the they've just regenerated, how do they handle it story. If you're going to do that, kill Capaldi off, have him change, then you have your Christmas special or whatnot, something like that, where it's their first story. And then go away and don't give us anything for 9 months. And then come back. And for that doctor, some time has passed. So that by the time we meet them again, it's like, oh shit, who is this guy?
See, I wouldn't want to do another Christmas special with a freshly regenerated doctor. I think you should regenerate at the end of a Christmas special.
Oh, that's what I mean. What about a two-parter? So, like, Christmas Day is part one of the story, and he's killed and regenerates at the end, and then part two is New Year's Day.
I want the new series to kick off with a fresh doctor.
Yeah, fair play. I think people would be devastated if you didn't have give him his scene to go from one to the other.
I think this is one of those things where, like, people are going to be upset no matter what happens.
Yeah,
but I think at this point we just got to go, yo, Chibnall, do what you want to do. But don't do to try and please anyone. Do what you think is going to work.
Yeah.
Not do what you think people on Tumblr are going to like.
God, yeah. You know what that's I mean? That's my only note. Do not look to the internet for your pointers.
Don't worry about upsetting or pleasing people on the internet. Just do what you think is best for the show. Yeah,
and if we've the last time they did sort of a reboot of sorts, it went for the fairy tale vibe, and that worked really well.
Yeah, yeah.
So this time you need to either go back to sort of relatable and a bit goofy, like in 2005, or you need to go like, I don't know, like slick sci-fi, but with that quintessentially British like heart to it.
Yeah, bring it back a bit of the Douglas Adamsy feel of some of the better episodes.
Yeah, I was watching. Is a good example. I started watching Dirk Gently yesterday on Netflix.
Oh, how is
the,
that?
The new American adaptation. It's all right. I didn't expect it to be one story over 8 episodes.
Oh,
so it seems to be piling a lot into each episode. I'm going to stick with it to the end of the run because I'm enjoying it enough, and I'm intrigued enough by the mystery. But what's nice about that is the whole thing is this sort of slightly violent, scary kidnap story that happens to have these two or three very eccentric characters in the middle of it. And that works. And Dirk, especially, because he's a bit different. What I love about it is I don't think any depiction of Dirk Gently has been anything like the books, because in the books he's like a schlubby, overweight kind of private eye stereotype. Stephen Mangan was not that in the BBC like 4 version, and the guy in the American version is definitely not like that. He's this super scrawny beanpole in a skinny jacket.
Yeah.
But it works. Like the character works very well. He feels very doctory. And it works quite well because it's an American show, but the moment he rocks up into it, it suddenly feels very British.
Hmm.
Because it's that Douglas Adams sensibility. Like Max Landis has created his own version, but has definitely kept the spine of the idea.
Ooh, that's
it feels in a case.
Douglas Adams' spine
in a case above his mantle. But it. Do you know what I mean? It still feels British at times.
Yeah. Yeah.
And having a British actor play that part definitely helps too.
Well, that's something.
Fiona Dourif is fucking phenomenal in it. She is great.
Oh, cool.
She's so good. Like she's terrifying. And Elijah Wood is really good in it as well.
Would he though? Would he?
Ba-dum-bum, ba-dum-bum.
Hey!
Oh, thank you. We're here all week, except we're not.
Who really would?
Giggity.
Lewis Christian, whose views you may or may not endorse.
We may or may not endorse your views, but and hey, keep them coming.
With some quick fire questions.
Quick fire questions from Lewis Christian.
Hello! first one. Here we go. Strap yourself in. Let's get through these. Matt Smith had two rather fake-looking ones, and John Hurt sported a slightly grizzled one. How would you feel about Doctor Who having a full-time beard on his chops?
I was kind of disappointed to find out Capaldi didn't keep that gigantically coiffured facial fuzz when he was cast.
Yeah, the stuff he had for Musketeers.
Musketeers, yeah. I was like, oh, okay, like slightly piratey-looking Doctor, fair enough.
Yeah, that could have been fun.
I'd be fine with a Doctor with a beard. Just, you know, don't go the Tumblr route and try and make it like a Stark or Doctor Strange beard. Just let him have a beard.
I could go with the beard.
I kind of dig those pictures of Colin, you know, those press shots.
Yeah, bearded Colin. I'm all right with bearded Colin.
It works. He looks like a fuzzy Paddington Bear man. He looks like Rupert the Bear with a busty companion.
He looks like Rupert the Bear. Yeah. Rupert for the next Doctor.
Rupert the Bear and Perry the Twink. Okay, next one.
Oh, dear. I feel like minisodes...
Stop it.
I feel like minisodes and bonus scenes often get overlooked or not enough love. So which minisodes are your favourites and why? This can range from stuff like Time Crash, the old Tardisodes, to Attack of the Grask, to charity skits, Matt Smith minisodes, the lot. Night of the Doctor, next question.
Yeah, let's be honest. That's the one. That's the one. I have a huge spot for the Tardisodes from series 2. Some of our younger listeners might not even remember those because they might not have been able to go on computers at that age. But the Tardisodes were amazing. Like just these little sort of minute long prequels to each episode that just sort of introduced a bit of, because it made you realize that this show is great because every week we're somewhere different. And those Tardisodes sort of geared you up. They were like a little teaser trail.
Yeah. Like they were nice little things.
Like the, if I remember correctly, the one for Tooth and Claw was the monk who has the lupine wavelength hemoveriform inside him being attacked. Like it's an on the moors wolf attack. And it's great because you sort of get to see the guy who, when you're in the episode, is just the creepy Scottish dude. And the Army of Ghosts one was a newscast, wasn't it, about the ghost cycle being more frequent?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That shit was excellent. So good. Oh man, I dug those. Because the one for I think it was the one for Doomsday was just like they came to light, like they shimmered out of their ghost form and attacked the newscaster. And it was like, oh my god, that's amazing.
Yeah.
It was like, yes, bitch, this is so cool.
It sounds like people used to care about the show more.
I know, right? But Night of the Doctor. Night of the Doctor, absolutely, yeah. And I've got a soft spot for Time Crash as well. Oh, and Children in Need short. Yeah.
Children in Need, Pudsey Cutaway.
Yes.
The Wedding of Sarah Jane Smith or Death of the Doctor, and why? Wedding of Sarah Jane Smith because I prefer David Tennant. That's the only reason.
Death of the Doctor, because I just love the idea that we're finally seeing two of the OG companions meeting up. And it was nice to get that glimpse of Matt being written by Russell.
And written
very well.
Yeah.
Plus giant vultures.
Yes. Okay, I'll give you that. Number four, if this hasn't already been discussed, please rank all the Doctor Who Christmas specials in order from best to worst, or fave to least fave. To make Chris even happier, feel free to class The Unquiet Dead as a Christmas special too. No!
Yay!
It's not! It went out in fucking May or whenever. But okay.
I think you'll find out it went out in April. So yeah. I'll
punch you in the dick, Christopher, when I see you for that. Yeah? That's what you're going to get for that one.
Merry Christmas, one and all.
Merry Christmas.
I don't count Quiet Day. I mean, it's very sweet of you, Lewis, but if we count that, we'd have to count Feast of Stephen as well.
Funnily enough, No.
should we pick up our favourite and our least favourite? Because I think ranking them would crush my soul.
Because
I'd have to think about them again.
The best one is the first one. It's the
Christmas Invasion. Yes. Oh, Christmas Invasion's excellent.
Yep.
I've got to agree. I think that's the best one. I think it's just because it's a proper Christmas prezi. Like, it's a really cool adventure with a character that we got to know and love over the course of a series. And then it gets to the point where she can't deal with it. Like, no, she's run out of options. They're screwed. But she's fought so hard and so long. Like, she's been so brave to keep it going this long that it's such a relief when the Doctor's like, I'm back. And also, what a great, like, because obviously he speaks in Children in Need special and a couple times in the episode, but what a great, hi, I'm the new Doctor, scene that entire section is. It's so good.
It's pretty good. It's pretty good.
I don't know!
It's great. It's great.
There's the a freaking Hitchhiker's reference.
Oh yeah, I'll put that in Doctor Who. Hitchhiker's reference is
odd. Worst one. The worst one used to be the Doctor, Widow and the Wardrobe for me.
That is a pretty bad one.
It's terrible.
Do you think it's fair to say that they've gotten worse as they've gone on?
Absolutely.
Like,
yeah.
In general.
The last one I enjoyed was The Snowmen. I think a lot of that is to do with the fact that we didn't know the pain we were yet to have of Clara.
Yeah.
We were meeting another fragment
at that point,
Yeah, this character was really like, what's she called in that one? She's called Clara, I think, isn't she?
She's the governess.
Yeah, she's great in that. Jenna Coleman's great in that. Like she was great in Asylum of the Daleks, but then when you see other women written by Moffat, you go, oh, she's just copy and paste.
Yeah,
right, okay. She sort of has an enthusiasm in that episode though, and then in The Snowman, she's great. It's the only time I've really liked her in anything, actually, and. Like, as much as I hate the idea of the Doctor moping because he lost his best mates in a really convoluted way, I do like the idea of him retiring for a bit and just picking Victorian England because sod it.
Because he did, it's a very 11th Doctor place to choose because they have lots of good times.
We hadn't got sick of the Paternoster gang yet, so that was kind of fun to spend time with them.
Yeah.
The Ian McKellen's kind of wasted. It seemed that Richard E. Grant was wasted, but then he wasn't, so fair enough. there's the whole thing of Strax wanting to bring a grenade, which was funny before, you know, they got overused.
Yeah.
But then, yeah, but before that was Doctor Widow and the Wardrobe, which I despised. For two reasons. One, it's just dull.
It is dull as dishwater.
And two, there's that whole, you know, oh, don't worry, I brought your dad back from the dead. Can you do that? I guess he can.
Apparently so.
Just like, oh, it's just so annoying.
I've liked them all progressively less.
I
still haven't bothered watching the Warsbins of River Song. I've not bothered.
Yeah, that is dire. That is really bad. And Last Christmas is pretty shit as well. I think for the worst, it still would Doctor Widow and the Wardrobe because I've watched that Last Christmas and Husband's a River Song once each, and by the time of Last Christmas, I was already sort of oh god, here we go, and by the time of Husband's a River Song, it was 8 months after it had aired, and I was watching it just to get it over with.
Yeah,
so I just was like, ugh, whatever. Whereas Doctor Widow in the Wardrobe, like, I came back to Manchester to have Christmas with my stepdad and my brother, and we sat there and went, the fuck is this?
Yeah.
So I've got a bit more of a hatred for that one.
It definitely says a lot that my dad, being the huge Doctor Who fan that he is, didn't bother to watch the Christmas special last Christmas Day. And I'm not sure he's going to bother with it this Christmas Day either.
Well, that's the question, actually. Yeah, are you going to be tuning in on Christmas Day?
Well, I'm going to be with my dad, so it depends what he wants to do. But
yeah, well, at least in that case, the two of you can sort of josh about it, and if it's shit, you can joke about it and everything.
Yeah.
But Yeah, I've got, like, Christmas Day is like my one day off this month. I'm traveling home. I'm not wasting. Yeah,
Doctor Mysterio.
Like last year, I was at home for Christmas, and even still, on the day, I went no, just can't be bothered.
No,
like it's 5:30. We've just finished eating. I'm in a great mood. I'm going to have another drink, and we're going to have some dessert. This will be great. Awesome. So I won't be watching it go out this year. God, it looks awful.
Yeah, it doesn't look good.
It looks so bad.
Last word.
I feel
from
so
Lewis
sorry
Christian.
For Capaldi.
Last word from Lewis Christian. And finally, a very happy Christmas to all of you at home.
Hey!
Love from Mrs. Doubtfire. Okay, two more emails, and then we can rest. Billy Tracy.
Oh my God, Billiam Tracy.
Yeah, good old Billy Treacle. Dear big damn lads, hope things are well with you both and that Chrissy's feet haven't caught fire from panto dancing and that Matt's not broken down on the shopping room floor surrounded by customers asking inane questions with seemingly no regard for his now dribbling semi-conscious state. Wow, that got vivid. Yes, it did, and it's all accurate. Question
okay.
time.
She would tell Ejiofor's character from Dirty Pretty Things.
Okay. Question time.
We are the ones who fix your cars, wash your rooms, and suck your cocks.
Oh.
Okay.
Oh. That took a dark turn.
Good film.
I'm alarmed this hasn't already been asked, or maybe it has, in which case, please ignore everything. To both of you, if you were to have a superpower, what would you use it for, and what would your alias be? Pretty standard, right? But here is where it gets interesting. Your co-host is now your supervillain nemesis. What would their power and alias be? And what would be their evil master plan? I hope this is something to be interesting to you both and sparks the beginning of both of your new respective superhero cinematic unitards. Before I go... I just want to thank you both for keeping me entertained for hours on end. Week after week, you make my morning shifts bearable. Thanks for your time and Merry Christmas. Your favorite Who fan, Billy. P.S. I weep every night knowing Matt's vision for his DC Cinematic Universe shall never come to pass. That's very sweet of you, Billy. I don't know why I turned you into someone else towards the end there. I just came over all a bit funny.
Hello, my name is Bellatrice.
I don't know what I'm doing, but it's what I'm doing now. I don't know what that is. I don't know what that was.
Oh God,
I'm so tired. I just napped for 4 hours today and I'm still exhausted. So, Christopher, if you were to have a superpower, what would you use it for, and what would your alias be? And then what kind of supervillain would I be in response to you?
I guess we've got to be heroes, haven't we? Because the thing is, if I had a superpower, I'd just have like flight and make travel a million times easier.
You'd be flight.
Yeah, but if I've got to be a superhero alias. Oh, there you go. I would be the trains are on time, man. I wouldn't actually affect the trains. I'd just be on time to things. I'd be able to fly to my desired destination, and you would be Leaf on the Rails, man.
Yeah.
my Count Leaf on the Rails, where basically every now and again you would show up wacky races style with some form of really shit obstacle that makes me at least 2 minutes late to any given appointment.
Nice.
You like swine!
It. I like what
you
done,
swine! Man. Count like Leaf on the Rails. Our biggest fight would be at the queue in a newsagent's, because I'd be like, "I'll just grab a Mars bar and then make my way to my meeting." And then you'd—that'd be just like one old man in front of me, and you'd rock up next to him and be like, "Hello, sir. Can I help you get to the front?" And I'd be like, "No!"
And I would just rip off to the skies and go, "Ah-ha! I'm Leaf on the Rails, man, all along. I'm not an old man, but I am an old man, because I've been waiting so long for this train." I don't know what that voice I'm doing is. I don't know where it's coming from.
And playing the role of Billy Tracy is Matthew Watson.
Oh, God. If I were to have a superpower, You know, I'm going to be really boring and serious and say if I had a superpower, I'd be a bruiser. Like, I'd be, like, Hulk slash Thing style, misunderstood, outcast, super strong dude. I don't know why. It just feels like a natural evolution. I would use it for doing good things, like building bridges. I'd be a super construction worker. And my alias would be... lift and carry man. And you...
you... I'd be your polar opposite, lifter carrion.
No, no. You would be the health and safety executive.
Oh, so I think I'm fighting for a noble cause.
Yes. And every time I try and do some ridiculous feat of superpowered construction, you're like, no, you can't lift that load. It's bigger than your head. You can't lift that. You can't lift those iron bars higher than your shoulders. And you would slow down all my constructions. And all
you can't office, use that coffee pot. It's not been pack tested.
All the office buildings and affordable homes that I'd be making for people. Yes, that's what you would do. That's my completely serious suggestion.
God, I'm a bastard in your fantasies.
Yeah, you are. But then you're also a bastard in real life.
That is true. That is very true. I would be Dr. Mysterio Ghostman, and my power would be to click pathetically and shatter sugar glass.
Awesome. Awesome.
Coming soon to a TV screen near you.
I like what you're doing.
There you go.
Final email. It's Jacob.
What?
It's Jacob. Hello, Chris and Matt. Well, it's a bit weird not writing in about class, but I take it was a good thing. I will write in about the return of Dr. Mysterio, whether you like it or not. Ooh, no. Reference, and brings back good memories of that alien spy Perry getting a good strangle. And I was kidding, it's your podcast, you're in charge. No, writing about Dr. Mysterio, we'll be talking about it, probably. Maybe if we watch it. I don't know if we'll watch it. We'll watch it, probably not.
Probably not.
Rogue One.
That'll be more important. There'll be more important things to talk about, like Rogue One. Yeah.
You watch it for us. Rogue One comes out on Thursday or Friday. I can't remember exactly. And I can't be asked to check anyway. I'm neither looking forward to it nor dreading it. I'm in the middle. Not because it looks boring, just because I don't know why. Maybe I'll get more excited as the week progresses. Maybe you will. Who knows? It's fine not to be excited about it. It's a movie. It's not the most important thing in the world. Oh yeah, I just remembered the Spider-Man Homecoming trailer was released this week, and I bloody loved it. So did we. I don't know if I'm biased, as Spider-Man is and will always be my favourite superhero, and Tom Holland is the best Superman. Tom Holland is the best Superman we've had in the Marvel Cinematic Unitard. I just realised this is only Spider-Man we've had in the Marvel Cinematic Unitard. You were very tired when you were writing this, weren't you, Jacob? But I understand what you mean. Yes, no, Tom Holland's great. Tom Holland's a great Spider-Man. And yeah, Homecoming looks really good. Oh yeah, I also forgot about Guardians of the Galaxy. Last week Chris was saying how in the trailer he felt they were trying too hard until he watched it again, and that's exactly how I felt. But what a trailer it was. It looked so ruddy good. Only a true British person would say ruddy good. That's very true. True British person.
True that.
Now
true
that. Ooh. Now for Doctor Who questions. Before any of the questions, I want to address something that happened while watching Doctor Who on the television. For record, I never watched Doctor Who on the telebox, in fear or mockery and scorn from my family. Well, you don't have to be afraid. Doctor Who's great. So the other day...
Hang on. It might be the repeats from the last 3 years. I completely understand.
But no. So the other day, I decided to watch Remembrance of the Daleks on the telebox while I was alone. But unfortunately, my father came in and compared Remembrance of the Daleks to Batman vs. Superman. As he knows how much I hate Batman vs. Superman with a fiery passion. Sorry, just went on a long tangent there. Yeah, that's very sad. So here's my first question is, what's better, Batman vs. Superman or Remembrance of the Daleks?
Remembrance of the Daleks.
How can you like Genesis more than Remembrance? It's so dull and only has four Daleks, which has always bothered me. I love Genesis. Remembrance is great, though. I do like Remembrance. I just like Genesis more. Because I do. So there. God, remember the Daleks is miles ahead of Batman vs Superman. Easy one.
Batman vs Superman does not have a scene where Ace smashes a Dalek to pieces with a baseball bat, so it automatically loses.
It wins. It wins because of that. Okay, questions. Favorite Doctor Who track from the soundtrack? I like all the new versions of the theme, and also the Matt Smith Doctor theme. That they use for
I like the Utah version from the Series 6 soundtrack. For me, it's probably, for me, my favourite tracks are I think it's called Who is the Doctor? The music used for Eccleston. You know, the
the wailing woman. Yeah.
Which eventually becomes Valche Diem at the end of Tennant's run. I really like Rose's theme. And I really like Amy's theme, actually, from Series 5, from Episode 1. Ooh. You know that one? Ooh. Those themes are nice. Plus the Dalek music from Bad Wolf Part of the Ways, which is just that massive demonic choir.
That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
Because you suddenly go, oh shit, these things mean business.
There's lots of...
Considering Series 1 was mostly, like, recorded by Murray Gold with some software in a room, to then have that track, which is just like, oh my god, a chorus of, like, 70 people. It sounds incredible.
Music really come along.
Yeah. And I've got a huge soft spot for sort of all of the themes sort of from like the 70s to the mid 80s, I'd say, as well.
Yeah, that a lot of that incident, like the late 80s stuff, I'm really fond of. Like the Sylvester stuff, I quite like. Like the it's really like ridiculous synthy music. That what's his name does. He works for the restoration team as well.
Billy Hum Hay.
Billy Hum Hay, that's his name.
Hello, I'm Billy Hum Hay. Yeah.
Like all the stuff from like Curse of Fenric and Survival and all that kind of that. Blinky.
Alright, the music.
Oh, Logopolis has great music. Logopolis has great music.
Oh yeah, it does, yeah.
Favourite Doctor Who writer other than Rusty T. It can also be a classic writer. Robert Holmes, next question.
Douglas Adams.
Of course. Mm. I don't really think Robert, of him as a Doctor Who writer, I guess, but yeah.
Robert Holmes, very, very close second.
Yeah, Robert Holmes, he wrote some great stories.
And then Rob Sherman, because one and done, and what a freaking one, you know?
Yes, very, very true.
Like, as far as his track record goes for episodes, freaking immaculate.
Favourite Christmas special? We've just covered it. Obviously, it's the Husbands in River Song, I say with as much sarcasm as I have. All my sarcasm! Christmas Invasion. Christmas Invasion all the way.
What's your favourite? Their potential. From the day they arrived on the planet and blinking, stepped into the sun. There's more to see than can ever be seen. More to do than... Hold on. That's a Lion King. the point still stands. Let them go. It's just like, yeah.
It's true. It's great. I love it. I love the Christmas event. What's your favourite Seventh Doctor story?
Ooh. For me, it's probably Remembrance. But I have a huge soft spot for Survival. Because, like, getting to see him and Ainley together, like, it's such an interesting, odd version of the Doctor-Master relationship.
It's an interesting and odd story. And that last season is an interesting and odd last season. I really like
Curse of Fenric. Fenric is another one.
I really like Curse of Fenric.
But if someone said to me, pick one to watch, I'd probably pick Remembrance.
I'd go Fenric. Definitely.
Ooh, baby. Once you go Fenric, baby, you never go Benric.
Hey! Favourite one-off villain, like Sutek or the Sea Devils? The Sea Devils were not a one-off villain. They came back. There was a couple of Sea Devil stories.
Did they? They really?
Warriors did of the they, Deep.
Yeah, did was that really them, or was that costumes that sort of looked like them?
It was them.
Must we count Warriors of the Deep as canon?
shut up.
I'm a sucker for Wotan.
Yeah.
Just because he says he has the balls to say Doctor Who.
No, I think Sutek was. I love Sutek so much.
Oh, do you know what? If you're going for Sutek, I'm gonna go for the sequel, The Beast.
Oh yes,
because that works so well.
If you look round, you'll die.
The valiant child will die in battle so very, very soon.
It's just like, oh, you're great, and you're just a voice. I mean, that's. I think technically our answer is just Gabrielle Wolfe. Like, that's our answer. Like,
yeah.
Gabrielle Wolfe is the greatest one-off villain because he got to be the one-off villain twice.
That's fine.
He's so good.
Christopher?
Matt-stopher.
How old were you when you were introduced to Doctor Who?
I was five. It was 1996.
I was younger than I can remember.
Oh, madam.
I can't remember a time when I did not watch Doctor Who.
My God.
That's my dad for you.
My God, sir.
Favourite one-off companion? Mine personally would be either D84 or Wilf.
D84 is a good choice.
Wilf. You already know I'm going to pick D84 because you know I love D84.
Say it. Just say it.
Oh, please do not throw hands at me. It's so great. I love Robots of Death so much. It's one of my favourite stories. And D84 is great.
I think if we are just picking one, it's Wilf. Because you get one story with Cribbins as the companion, and you finish it going, I could have watched a whole series of those two.
Yeah,
like, no, Wilf's wonderful.
Wilf is good.
Although I do have a soft spot for Astrid, because it's a bit of a, you know, cliche. Oh, I'm the big dreamer Disney princess kind of part. Yeah. But Kylie Minogue's enthusiasm really sells it.
Yeah,
like she's a wonderful character, and it's such a shame when she. Spoilers, sort of, dies, because it's like, oh, okay. His story probably would have been very different had she lived.
I would have thought so.
Yeah.
Finally, from Jacob, I'll save it for questions, but before I say goodbye, I want to thank you for the advice you gave me last week, so I've decided to start writing a blog called The Doctor Who Unitrad Reviewer, which is brilliant, because you felt unitard wrong as well, which is awesome. and he sent us the address. It's the Who Unitrad Reviewer. So I'll put the link in the show notes. Give you a little signal boosting. It's Unitrad and Reviewer, R-E-V-I-W-E-R. So yeah, again, I think you said you was dyslexic, Jacob. So don't worry about that. It's fine.
It adds to the charm. It gives it jokes completely aside. It gives it a unique name.
So. He's only just started it, so it's got we've got what we got. We got a couple of reviews from last week. Dedicated a rose review to us, which is very sweet of him. Reviewed Horror of Glam Rock, so he's going everything. It's not just TV stuff.
So nice.
Give that a go.
Good work, man. Chris
Fenric. Oh, I've got Curse of Fenric coming up as well. Excellent. Good work, Jacob. Carry on. Don't worry about, like, I know you said you're learning difficulties, it's difficult spelling things like that. Don't worry about it. Just good practice for you. Get it out there. Give it a go. Doesn't matter if no one reads it. Just need to get it out there and give it a shout. Lots of love, your biggest fan, Jacob. Yay! Thank
Huzzah!
You,
Jacob. Bye, Jingo, Always Jacob, Jingo, Jacob, 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 Jing.
Oh, also, P.S. I saw the other day that the poster in the word, for class has the word Unifers on it, so I changed it to the correct spelling of Unitrad or BBC. Can you get anything right? And he has indeed sent us a poster of class saying class from the Unitard of Doctor Who. Lovely little Photoshop job there. I love it. Thank you, Jacob, as always. We'll give your blog a shout. Yeah, that's it for us. That's all our questions. We've got through more, Chris!
My God! Actually, have we cleared the inbox? Oh my God!
And how long's the show going on? We're not too long either. Yay!
Yay!
Now,
oh my God!
What,
Matt? There's a There's a dump truck pulling up to the driveway filled with electronic mail.
No. 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 Don't do it. No, do continue to send us things, as always. Tweet us at BigDamnCast. Email us at BigDamnContact@gmail.com for longer stuff. Oh, we haven't done the Twitters for a while. We'll have to catch up on the Twitters soon.
Oh, yes.
We'd love to hear from your questions, comments, whatever you got. If you're listening on iTunes, please do leave us a review. Just helps us get out there. And also, we want to know what you think so we can make the show better. You can find stuff from us at Big Damn Cast on Twitter and also bigdamnblog.tumblr.com. As I mentioned earlier, the episode that is coming out next week has already been recorded, so there won't be another regular episode until after Christmas. The week
by Jing,
to be exact. Just before the new year, I believe. So we will hear from you. We will. Any questions that you send to us in the next week or so, we won't get to until the week after. So just bear that in mind.
But we will promise you a rather unusually spectacular Christmas special.
It's going to be a hell of a show, although we're still going to be separated by distance and time until the week after. It's going to be a while. It's going to be a couple of episodes. It's going to be a couple of episodes till we're back in the same room again. But so, again, thanks for bearing with any audio issues and whatever. We're doing what we can. Thank you for listening, as always. I've been Big Damn Matt.
I've been Big Damn Chris about it.
And we'll leave you with your last minute Christmas shopping and go and see Rogue One, apparently. Bye!
Good day. Bye.
Ooh, I love it.